So I'm just going to take 2 or 3 minutes to tell you a story of compassion and red bicycles. So there's a red bicycle on the front of this building, and many folks in this room have asked me what's up with the red bicycle, but I'm going to start with compassion. Karen Armstrong and I are friends. We became friends in the space of our mutual eccentricities, our mutual dysfunctions, and the space of those dysfunctions is quite broad, so our friendship is quite interesting. And I adore Karen for many reasons, but for her, compassion is an intellectual construct. Love for her actual neighbor, compassion for her actual neighbor, maybe not so much. But the most viscerally compassionate human being I've ever had the pleasure to have known was Muhammad Ali. And our lives, my life and Muhammad Ali's life have been interestingly intertwined. So Muhammad Ali was born Cassius Clay. He lived in the west part of Louisville. He would ride his bicycle everywhere when he wasn't running. And there was an event in this building, upstairs in the ballroom where you had lunch. And it was a home show, and they had free popcorn and hot dogs. And so Cassius Clay rode his bicycle to this building. He parked it outside. He went upstairs. He ate popcorn and hot dogs. And he went outside, and his bicycle was gone. It's a rough part of town you're in. And he said, "I'm going to whoop somebody up. They stole my bicycle." And he's crying. And people said, "There's a police officer down in the basement. If you want to go and tell him, he might be able to do something about it." So he goes down, and he's saying, "I'm going to whoop somebody up. They stole my bicycle." And he goes, "Well, if you're going to try to beat someone up, you should learn how to box." The policeman's name was Joe Martin, and he taught Muhammad Ali how to box in the basement of this building. So fast forward. I was a young person in the mayor's office, met Muhammad and Lani Ali. Then I later tried to row a boat alone across the ocean. I'm going to abridge that story. I was hit by a hurricane, didn't make it. Returned to Louisville, Kentucky, home of all great ocean rowers. And I was asked if I wanted to take a job working for Muhammad Ali. And you don't get to be the world champion 3 times if you don't lose twice along the way. Muhammad and I could not be more different. You can't spend 2.5 months alone in a rowboat if you're not an introvert. Muhammad was an extrovert, but he understood where I was as a human being better than I understood where I was. I was in a pit of despair, and he just sort of nudged me every now and then and said, "Kid, you gotta get up." So I was the first full-time employee of the Muhammad Ali Center. It didn't exist. I like to say yes to things that don't exist. And it was Muhammad Ali who said, "Tori, you don't want to go through life as the woman who almost rode across the ocean." So I became the president of Spalding University, our lives circle, all our lives circle, not just mine. And he passed away last June. And it was commencement weekend, and it was very difficult for me to get through the commencement ceremony because Muhammad Ali had passed away the night before. I managed to do it, but the next morning I got up and I just had to do something to honor Muhammad. So I went to the garage, and I knew my husband had an old bicycle from his daughter named Clay, a little red Schwinn, and I pulled it out of the garage, and as it was coming out, I heard it bounce down the stairs, this clang. And I turned, my husband's daughter is like late 30s, early 40s. This would have been her bicycle when she was around 10. This was last year. There's this clang, and there was a red bar that you could use to turn this girl's bicycle into a boy's bicycle. And so I put ribbons on the wheels, and I rappelled out the window of the ballroom and hung the bicycle off the side of the building. And the funny moment was a campus safety officer rode by, looked up, saw the president, and kept riding. You know. And after that week, I took the bicycle down because I didn't want to be disrespectful. It was just supposed to be our little nod, tip of a hat to Muhammad Ali. And I got such hate mail for taking down the bicycle that we put it back up.
That is the best. See, look where we are. There are no accidents. It's just amazing. I'll introduce quickly our next panel, and then we'll have our moment of silence, and we'll begin the session. You have had the pleasure, I hope, I certainly have, of hearing from all three of our panelists already. And I'll start with our moderator, Patrick Holden, who is not only dear to me, but also to our festival and to our team at CIR for his just longtime support of our work and his solidarity with us. And I think you've heard his bio, so I won't read it. I don't have it to read anyway. But he's a farmer in West Wales and runs the Sustainable Food Trust out of Bristol. And I think you've got the full bio earlier. And actually, you've gotten the full bio on all of these amazing people. Also will be Marc Andrus. Bishop Marc is the Bishop of California, which has him based in San Francisco and leading the Bay Area in such just essential work. And living there as I do, I can tell you his impact is extremely important and very, very vital these days especially. And we're so glad to have Marc back in Louisville, a place that he too has been many times, and also a solidarity member of the those of us hoping to have solidarity people for the Festival of Faith Club. And actually, that would make a third member. This is a panel, I'm realizing, all filled with our solidarity people. Elizabeth Mattis Namgyel, who many of you know, has been here now many, many times, to the festival many times, and to Louisville, independent of the festival, many times. I think she feels at home here. We're certainly glad that you do, Elizabeth. Please, please always feel at home here. And as you know, she is a published author of her first book, The Power of An or The? The Power of An Open Question, better than The, and her forthcoming book, The Logic of Faith, will be out soon. And so before they come to the stage, we'll have our brief moment of silence and then begin. And welcome to the stage, dear panelists.
Well, it's an honor to have been invited to moderate this last session, and that gives me a really good excuse to just read one or two things from the program, just to remind you what we're going to be exploring. But before I do that...
I want to hear that too.
There we are. before I do that, the session is going to end promptly at 3:30, but we're going to break it around 45 minutes to see a film. After which I'm going to invite a third panelist to join us, a special guest. So stick around for that. And I'm hoping that we will have two interventions to start the conversation going, as long as you both need. But don't forget that you can save some of your best thoughts to share in an exchange, which will follow it. And then, half an hour before the end or so, I would like to open the conversation up to the floor so we can have an exchange with all of us. So here's what I will briefly read about this session. The nature of interdependence. A conversation on the nature of interdependence from both Eastern and Western faith traditions. And a quote, a wonderful quote from Thomas Merton at the bottom. The whole idea of compassion is based on a keen awareness of the interdependence of all these living beings, which are all part of one another and all involved in one another. So, Elizabeth, if you'd like to go first and share your thoughts.
I'll start up here. First of all, I'd just like to thank everyone involved in putting this amazing event together. I know how much work it takes. Just starting with Owsley and Sarah and everyone, thank you so much. It's such an opportunity for all of us to come together and open up some very important, very huge ideas. And I'd like to thank everyone here. And mostly, I think I'd like to thank all the panelists that have come before me, because they've made it extremely difficult to plan what I'm going to say. And I appreciate that, because what it means is I can't really rest in my own rightness, if I can make that a word. I can't rest on my assumptions. I can't hold on to views. That I'm always willing for these things to fall apart. And that's the beauty of interdependence, you know, that we influence each other, and that what we understand our life to be is this playful exchange of our inner and outer worlds. And I find that extremely exciting. So that somewhat speaks to the nature of interdependence. So what we're asked to do in the beginning here is to, I'm going to try to express to the best of my ability what interdependence means in the context of my own tradition, which is the Buddhist Mahayana tradition. And I think I will talk really about the essential, interdependence is really at the very essence of the Buddha's awakening and Buddhist teachings. So when the Buddha attained enlightenment, he talked about interdependence. Now when I use this word enlightenment, I think it's a very lofty word, and other traditions might not understand what this means. So I want to bring it back to the human condition, because it's not something impossible or remote to who we are. In my new book that I wrote, The Logic of Faith, which I just finished, I decided to talk about interdependence as living in grace. In other words, enlightenment is not something that happens in a vacuum, independent of everything else. Enlightenment has to do with who we are or how we understand ourselves in relationship to everything else. So not just to other people, but also to our inner world of, as we spoke of this morning, thoughts and emotions, and how we understand who we are in the midst of all of this. So I feel, well, we're in the South, I think we can say, and we always hear of, you know, how Southern of graciousness in the South, and I really see that here in Louisville. I feel people are so extremely gracious. So I think we all understand grace. Grace is not necessarily just a religious word. Grace speaks to, for example, you know, when somebody walks into someone's home, if a person is attentive to what the other person needs. Are you thirsty? Are you hungry? Where would you like to sit? This is gracious. So this is a way we talk about grace, just in a very ordinary way. Or we can talk about grace in terms of physical movement. For example, if someone's dancing on a stage, you know, they have a sense of who they are in relationship to the space around them. They're very in tune with how their body works, how it moves, what they can do, how it's going to work. This is also grace. So the Buddha's enlightenment, what we call the Buddha's enlightenment, has a lot to do with the Buddha found himself in insane relationship to his world, his inner and outer world, the physical world, the world of people, the world of the environment. And so this would be a way, or this is a way that I've talked about enlightenment. It goes very deep, but this is really at the crux of it. So when the Buddha sat beneath the Bodhi tree, which is where he attained enlightenment. This was in Bodh Gaya, India. He had, I guess you could say, an awakening or epiphany. And he said something very interesting. And the way he described it is almost like a secret formula that unlocks the secret of the universe in some way. And this is what he said. You might be familiar with this, but he said, "This being that becomes. From the arising of this, that arises. This not being, that becomes not. From the cessation of this, that ceases." So let me just say this again. This is very important, and don't worry, I'll open this up so it's very clear for you. So he says, this being, that becomes. So for example, if the causes and conditions of suffering are there, then suffering will arise. If the causes and conditions of happiness are there, happiness will arise. And everything works like that. If there's a right, there's a left. If there's a good, there's a bad. Everything arises. Independence on other things is basically what this means. So then, so from this being, that becomes, from the arising of this, that arises. And then this not being, that becomes not. If there are not causes and conditions for something to arise, like if you plant a seed and there's no good conditions, nothing will come of it. From the cessation of this, that ceases. So this is really the very heart of what the Buddha taught, because this is what he came to understand when he attained enlightenment. And this is part of absolutely every aspect of Buddhist thought and Buddhist practice. So basically, you know, what we're talking about is relationship here. And I think what I'm going to do, well, before I do that, I just want to introduce some words to you. So what this is called, we call this interdependence. But in the context of the Buddhist teachings, the Sanskrit word for this is pratitya samutpada. I don't know if you're there when the rabbi was doing the meditation practice on the first morning, but he talked about this very word, which excited me very much. So in Sanskrit, it's pratitya samutpada. Joanna Macy, the deep ecologist, calls it mutual causality or mutual reciprocity. It's also known as dependent arising or dependent origination. There are many other ways to talk about it. I tend to say that it's the nature when we understand that everything leans against each other, and this makes all this movement. It makes everything happen. If things didn't lean, nothing would move. Everything would be inert. So really, when you're talking about Genesis in the context of Buddhism, you're talking about the movement of interdependent relationships. That's why we say this is a non-theistic tradition. Everything is a constant state of movement. There's nothing that exists independent or as singular or as permanent or static. So let me do a demonstration for you so this doesn't remain in the realm of abstract thinking, because this is a very practical, this becomes a very practical. So I hardly go anywhere without my three sticks. People who know me, well, I've actually requested to my spiritual community that when I die, I would like to have my three sticks burnt with me. I have a really strong connection to this particular teachings. And one thing I like, because it's Earth Day today, it feels so good to hold something natural, and I find this very grounding. And I love that wherever I go, I collect the sticks of the trees of where I'm staying. And these three sticks I got from Christy Brown's gorgeous garden, and I like them. The sticks are different everywhere. It's so amazing. So what I'm about to point out, no pun intended, is that, well, let's see. So I'm holding up this stick. And I might need a little bit of audience participation. I can't see you so well, but call it out, okay? This can't happen just me alone. This is a group effort. So if I were to ask you, is this a big stick or a small stick, what would you say? Some people say big, some people say small. What else did I hear? Medium. Anything else? It depends. That's what I was looking for. And this is, by the way, this was a teaching that was talked about by a teacher named Chandrakirti, a great Indian master. I don't know if he used the sticks to illustrate it, but it's in his text. I want to point that out to feel connected to my lineage. Okay, so now I'm pointing out this stick, and I put it next to this stick. What does this stick become? It's bigger than this stick, right? Now if I hold up this stick, what happens to this stick? It becomes smaller. So let me ask you something. Does the size of this stick exist in the stick itself? It depends upon what it's next to. So you might say, well, you know, you could say this stick is, I don't know, it's hard to measure, but 2.5 feet long. Is that intrinsic in the stick? No. Why? Because measurement is just a man-made contrivance. It's a fabrication and a very, very useful one. I want to say that size and measurement are extremely important and powerful. We've built cathedrals based on measurements. Our whole world is based on measurements and numbers. And it's similar with language. It's like, what is language but a series of sounds that we agree upon in order to communicate with each other and participate in the world in which we live? So when I say that this object has no objective size, it's not to undermine the fact that these agreements we have about things and the relationship things have between each other are not extremely profound and powerful. We all know how powerful language is. We all know how powerful this world of relativity is. So this is sometimes gets confusing for people. When I was talking to Geshe Thupten Jinpa last night, and I was saying that I do this thing with the sticks, and he said that there was another teacher who did this, but she scared people. But it's scary because what this is saying is there's no intrinsic like truth about anything. So maybe people often interpret that as, oh, well, maybe it doesn't matter then what you do, or the world of relativity kind of loses its potency. But that's not true at all. The relationships are powerful. That's the main point. So it doesn't have an intrinsic existence or truth. There is actually no reality in the fact that things don't exist in the object itself, which means you can never be right. Well, that's powerful. It all depends on where you stand, because everything leans. This is the most extraordinary thing, personally, that I feel. It means you always have to be in awe in one way or another, that you can't really know anything in a determinate, definitive way. And I often think that we look at awe as like some kind of luxury or something that comes upon us, but that it's not very practical. But I think awe is extremely practical and extremely important in the context of everything that we've talked about. First of all, if there's no awe, there can be fundamentalism. When there's awe, there can be no fundamentalism. I even think despair is kind of a form of fundamentalism. I'm not saying that we shouldn't be touched. We can't help but be touched by the sadness in the world, by other people suffering. We can't help that. But when you expose despair to a little bit of awe, I feel it turns into compassion. So we have this tendency to reify. We look at a situation and we say, for example, what do we do about North Korea? What do you do with a question like that? You know, what do we do about animal cruelty or racism or all these different things that we've been talking about that are so significant and we must respond to these things? But these are big abstract ideas, and within these big abstract ideas are all kinds of things are going on. North Korea is a big place with lots of people, and it all depends on where you stand and how you see it. So we have this tendency to reify. We reify each other when we only look at the color of a person's skin. Like when we're at our best, we don't do that. We really look at the human condition. We see some kind of inner beauty. We don't know. Like I was saying at lunch, that the greatest respect that we can have for anyone or anything is not to assume we know who they are. So I feel like this has a very practical place in the realm of activism, or maybe our ability to respond with intelligence to the world in which we live. In fact, you know, one of the ways we talk about this, it's very interesting. We either think, oh, things exist and they're true, or else they're not true. We're very dualistic. There's a great teacher called Mipham Rinpoche who said, the way our minds are so dualistic, they're like an elephant. They roll in the mud, no, they roll in the water to rinse off the dirt, but then they have to roll in the dirt to dry off. You know, we tend to see through a dualistic lens, but when you say everything leans, you can't say it's one and you can't say it's two. It's non-dual. And this is very powerful. This has been very powerful for me, because I feel the world is really magical. And when I feel that I'm right and things are stuck in their place, I'm also stuck in my place. Mm. It's actually the Buddha said that all the negative emotions arise from reifying things, from thinking we know what they are, whether we think they're bad or terrible, or we think they're good and perfect. Like, to deify someone is very disrespectful because they can't be fully human. And to demonize someone is also disrespectful because we don't see all the causes and conditions for any one thing to happen. So, you know, I remember, actually in my first book, I had these examples, and I still think they're such good examples for me when thinking about this, how negativity arises from reification, making something real. Real doesn't mean you don't experience it here. Real means that the thing exists in the object. You get that, right? So, for example, during World War I, I read a statistic that they did this survey. They asked the veterans whether they would rather shoot or be shot at. And most of them, the large percentage of them, said that they would rather be shot than shoot someone else. And of course, the military got wind of this and they didn't like it. So they started to invent new tactics to indoctrinate the veterans, making them reify or objectify the enemy. After Vietnam, the statistics switched. They said they would rather shoot than be shot at, which is so saddening and alarming. So it shows that to look at someone in a one-dimensional way as the enemy means that we can't see the multidimensionality of who they are. So when I say multidimensionality, I mean we can't say that anyone is one singular thing. In the world of interdependent relationship, for example, if you were to look in the eyes of your enemy and say, oh, there's somebody's father, there's somebody's son, there's somebody's brother, you know, they're human, they feel things, it's going to be harder to be aggressive. That's why reification is seen as the root of all the negative emotions. This being that becomes, to reify creates the condition for negativity and a lack of compassion. And you can say the same thing, for example, with attachment. For example, the advertising industry understands reification. So when they advertise, they show you the one dimensionality of an object. Oh, here's this fantastic car. Look at, you know, how the commercials are. The sun is glimmering on the roof, and it's winding around the roads, taking the curves and all that. But, you know, when you start to think of parking tickets, insurance, you know, how the engine breaks down and the dashboard cracks, you might still buy the car, but you have much less of that graspy feeling. You have much more of a realistic idea of what that is. So this notion of open dimensionality, of looking at things with this kind of, this is what interdependence does. The purpose of interdependence in this tradition is to penetrate that sense of truth and realness. And I do hope that I think we're going to talk about this. Did I do my time? Okay. We can open this up more, but I feel I do want to talk about the practical nature of awe, and I do want to talk about how important it is to use interdependence as a tool to open ourselves out of this sense of thinking we know who something is or what a situation is. Even here on Earth Day, you know, when we fall into despair and we get angry at the state of the world or the state of our government or anything in particular, to understand that it all depends on how you look at it. It depends on the moment. There's causes and conditions that give rise to all things and so forth. And so that's how it functions in this particular tradition.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I think the fact that there are many faith traditions represented here, and my pathway is not the same as yours, makes this conversation really important. And what you brought, the constantly changing nature of everything, the relativity of things, this question about applied to the theme of this conference, compassion, which implies suffering, and even maybe the relativity of suffering. I think a rich conversation can come from that, which we can explore afterwards. But maybe, Mark, you could comment on what's already been said and give us your thoughts, and then we'll go into an exchange.
Oh, okay. Well, I know Elizabeth and I and Patrick are actually really dear friends, and I love your use of the sticks, and I can tell you that Elizabeth is a person who walks softly and carries a relatively large stick. It depends, you know, it depends. Thank you for that. But I love the interplay, the Buddhist teaching on interdependence has been very helpful to me. As I'll say when I speak in just a moment.
You can speak now.
Well, I will. I am. the West is recovering a sense of what inner being means, and Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, has given us a very fleshed out, really beautiful set of teachings, interlocking teachings, mm-hmm. on dependent co-arising, on emptiness, and on interdependence itself. And I have benefited so much from that and have yet so much more to learn from it. So I want to thank you for that. Well, let's see. Okay. So I thought we would have another little image tour like we had this morning. We'll see. Okay, I need to go back. So inner being is interesting, interdependence inner being is interesting to us today because it is the basis for compassion. And compassion is the basis for justice. And so here's three quotations. We've been looking at part of this quotation from Conjectures of a Guilty Bystander, Thomas Merton, his epiphany here in Louisville in the late 50s, all week, and the beautiful images of the shining sun, which is all of you, all of us. But this is the other part of, another part of that quotation. I was overwhelmed with the realization that I loved all these people. It was like waking from a dream of separateness, of spurious self-isolation. So that's interesting. There's a dream that's a background of isolation, of separateness. And this comes as a surprise to Thomas Merton. I think that's interesting to note that. 4 years later, 1963, this is a quotation from one of the great documents of the 20th century, a letter from a Birmingham jail, Martin Luther King Jr. All life is interrelated. All are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. This is the interrelated structure of reality. Beautiful, beautiful. Interesting that he had to say it. And then James Lovelock, who came up with the Gaia hypothesis, that started to come to him the next year, in 1964. And this is how one of his expressions of what Gaia meant. The entire range of living matter on Earth, from whales to viruses and from oaks to algae, could be regarded as constituting a single living entity. Again, this is beautiful, and many of us accept this, but it came as a surprise to many people. It was a deeply, deeply contested idea as he unfolded it. His book, Gaia, was not published until the beginning of the next decade, but 64 is when he started having this insight by having a view of Earth, as it were, from above, working on material about Mars. So I'd like to explore with you what happened, because before the Renaissance, the view in the West was as it has been in much of the rest of the world, up until even now, and that is that this is true, and that what Martin Luther King Jr. said was true, and that what Thomas Merton experienced as being true was true. So it was a commonplace. It was the worldview. It had variations, but it was absolutely commonplace, so much so that it was not questioned. The world was alive. Everything was integrated. Everything was interdependent. Somehow, between then and when these statements were made, we lost that. And something happened. So I'm going to use an illustration of how extreme it got before we started to move away. This is the coronation of Napoleon as the Emperor of France, and he hoped the Emperor of the world. This is 1804. This is David's over-the-top painting of this moment. he's crowning himself, typical Napoleon gesture. And 1804, this happened, and if you read Wikipedia, which is, you know, there are problems, but it it only mentions this in Napoleon's life in this moment in 1804, but this was also happening. This is the Haitian Revolution. Haiti was a French slave colony, meaning everybody who lived in Haiti was a slave except for the overlords. It was a slave colony, it was a sugar colony, also coffee and other products. And this was the slave population of Haiti defeated Napoleon's army in 1804, decisively. 12 French generals died in that overthrow. It was the first successful slave rebellion since Spartacus in Rome in late antiquity. Why don't we know that? Some people know. I can't really see out there. Just be honest. Raise your hands if you knew this. You're right. Tiny minority. There's more. So the reason that it was the most lucrative sugar slave colony in the Caribbean was because an extreme idea of the denial of interdependence. Mm-hmm. Interdependence was denied in two main ways. One, the earth was dead. It's an inert thing. It's an atomized collection of objects that is available for human use and abuse. And this is a picture currently of the border between Haiti on the left, on your left, and Dominican Republic on your right. This extreme deforestation and the resulting erosion has been going on since 1730 with the overuse of the earth. But there was no problem with that because the earth was simply a dead object to be used. The other non-human object to be used were the slaves. This is a picture of two children, slave children in New Orleans in the 19th century. One is dark and one is much lighter skinned, white. And the understanding of humanness, which was a convenience for the use of the people as tools and as objects, went from white equals human to black equals inhuman. So between the objectification of the earth and the objectification of the African origin slaves of Haiti, they worked that island, that half of the island, so severely that they extracted enormous profits from it and destroyed a people until they rose up and proved France and the rest of us to be wrong about their status on the earth. This is why nobody mentioned it and why we don't teach it, is this was a tremendous affront to the ideas that fueled the wealth of the West. And this is what we got out of it. Napoleon had to recoup his losses, and so all of this vast area of space was sold to Thomas Jefferson to help France recover the losses from Haiti. You may regard this as a Trojan horse because it reinforced new ways. The English colonists had their own ways of objectifying the earth and objectifying people of color, but the ways that had been used in Haiti came in through this former French area, which had 60,000 people living in it at the time of the Louisiana Purchase. 30,000 were black and 30,000 were white. And this was all in the service. This is Turner, the great 19th century English painter. He was obsessed with the Industrial Revolution and steam engines. This is one of his great paintings. And the steam engine amplified our power and made us the gods that we hoped we truly were. And so the use of the resources of the earth to fuel the Industrial Revolution and the enormous profits that it brought pushed this whole idea of interdependence further and further out of sight. But we suffered because of that. We suffered so much as people, all of us, the privileged and those who were on the receiving end of objectification. And we started to make a turn back. And this is one image of that turn back when we could see the earth as a whole. We began to recover. And so those little moments, those glimmers with Merton and with MLK and with James Lovelock were the beginning of what Joanna Macy calls the great turning, returning back to an idea of interdependence and compassion and justice built on a true understanding of the integrity of the earth and of all that is. So the great turning is not a circle. We're not going to go back to where we were before. We're going to be dragging all the experiences, this is how it is, all the experiences of the past 400 years with us, and we have a few things to look at with consciousness as we make this huge boat turn back towards an understanding of interdependence. I've named a few of them here. What are we going to do about the healing between the peoples? The peoples who have been objectified and those who objectified them. This is, we now see that what we hoped happened in the 60s was a scab on the wounds of our country and our world. We have much to do in consciousness about healing. Population, I needn't say more about that. We have to bring consciousness to what it means eventually, in not the far distant future, to be 9 billion people on the earth, from 7 to 9 billion. Climate change, as I said this morning, this is the long emergency, and the effects of this are for our children and our grandchildren and the generations of the other species, those that survive on the earth. What consciousness are we going to bring to that turning so that it is a spiral that is upward and not downward? And the last one, and this one is one that Owsley keeps reminding me because of my overemphasis perhaps on climate change, that the folks in Silicon Valley where I live, these folks are deeply concerned more about this than they are about climate change, and that is what they call the technological singularity. And that means that we have become cyborgs, that we are an amalgam of organic, inorganic, human, technological pieces put together and fused. The Z generation, the ones, the young people right now who are coming up, are people who are not just digital natives, they are people for whom technology is part of every physical aspect of their lives. We have not asked the questions in a way that we could hold them together about what does this mean morally, ethically, spiritually, humanly. So when we say the earth, we often use the word world, and that's incorrect. The earth is part of the world. The world is more than the earth. This is a picture of the world, the cosmos, in a medieval or an ancient view. And you see that it includes a lot, but it's actually encompassed. You know, it's if you could get up on Mount Olympus or Mount Zion or one of the great mountains, you were close to the top of all this. You were much closer, and the above you were the planets, and above that were the stars. Part of what we did in the denial of interdependence and the livingness of the integral world is to rob the cosmos of life as well. So it's not just the earth that's dead. It's those vast reaches reaching out to the stars and the planets. There's nothing there. We've been taught that the universe is like a great machine, and it's winding down. It's dying. And not only that, between here and everywhere else, it's just very cold, dead, vacuum space. That's what we've been taught. The great turning is going to give us our lives back. This is where we live. This is the Milky Way. And down on the right, about two-thirds out on that arm. That's where the Earth is. It's vast. The universe is unimaginably vaster, and it's not dead. It is full of love. And I'm out of time, so I'm just going to tell you that what we are going to recover in the living way of understanding that the love pervades the Earth, the cosmos, and the micro world, and your inner life is a warm universe, and the beautiful faces all shining like the sun. I'll see you, show you those again. Aren't they beautiful? Mm-hmm. And then finally this. And a very quick story. A woman, a middle-aged woman in Alabama when I was the bishop there, and I was waxing on about this stuff, and I said the quality of wonder, which Elizabeth, I think, calls awe, is a recognition of the relatedness, in my view, of all of us and the love that pervades everything, that makes our faces shine and everyone's face shine with beauty and makes the stars shine with the same love and down here. And I said, have you ever had an experience of wonder? I asked this group that. And this woman, who was a friend of mine, said, I've never told this story, but when I was a fourth grader, it was the first time I looked through a microscope. And they had prepared a slide with paramecium. And I saw the paramecium, and I fainted for the beauty of it. Mm. All of creation is shining like the sun, which is the love of God. Thank you.
Well, I thought that was the perfect compliment to the first perspective from Elizabeth, and I have a couple of questions. Much of this gathering has been informed by discussions about the need for compassion in a response to the suffering that we've inflicted on humanity through slavery, through abuse of the earth, and part of my question relates to the healing of that suffering, because I don't know how many people know about this, but I mentioned this morning, I mentioned epigenetics, and how, this is my very quick summary, all living organisms have a constant dynamic interrelationship with their external environment, which impacts on gene expression, and therefore we dynamically have this relationship with the external world. And this impact on us, both positive and negative, can be passed on between generations. And there was an experiment, I think undertaken by a Harvard professor, where he took some mice and he gave them a very strong smell. He then split the mice into two, and one batch had a mild but not lethal electric shock and the others didn't. And then he bred from them. And then two generations later, he exposed the grandchildren of the mice that had the shock after the smell, and the ones that hadn't, to the smell. And the grandchildren of the mice that had the shock after the smell became agitated. So the inference arising from that is that if traumas happen to a living organism, there is an intergenerational impact. And this, for me, frames a lot of the discussion which might arise from what you both said, because it introduces the idea of conflict and trauma and healing, but then it begs the question, can we heal it fully? Or is this just an ongoing cycle of events in which we find ourselves, which is relative? Like, you know, I often find myself responding to some difficulty in my life while I'm not in Syria, you know, or something like that. And so I would welcome both your comments on those initial thoughts.
Yeah, maybe I can say something. I mean, when we look at the nature of interdependence, you know, we can kind of see the origin, like why did we depart from that view?
Right.
It has to do with objectifying things or not feeling our connection to things, which is a fully embodied, it's not just an intellectual thing, it's how we feel ourselves, who we are, that we see, in fact, we know our place in the great nature of interdependent expression. I always think, yes, I'm a citizen of a town, I'm a citizen of a nation, I'm a citizen of this dazzling planet, but even more so, I'm a citizen of the great nature of infinite contingency. You know, so what does that mean for me as somebody who wants to respond to the world compassionately? How much efficacy can I have?
What's the answer?
Well, I think, you know, because everything leans, we can only see a little piece of things. We can read patterns, you know, and that's what we do, which they tend to be linear. We want to bring it from this to that. And like this one woman was saying, and I'm so sorry, her last name's Mattson. Yesterday, I can call her Ms. Mattson. My notebook I left over there.
Isabel.
What's her name?
Is it Isabel?
Ingrid Mattson said, we measure the progress of everything by the result. I thought that's very interesting, because in a world where everything leans, there is no final result. The verdict is never out. You know, one thing has reverberating effects. Nothing ever has a final conclusion.
But surely we need to strive.
We do. I'll get there.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think we need to know what we're working with as human beings, as a part of this nature. So what it means to me is that we're never in total command. And that's just a fact. We don't know what brought us here, what causes and conditions brought us here. We don't know where things will go. We only see things it depends on where we stand, how we see things. There is no singular right answer to anything. We all know that, because as you move about the world, you can see that, you know, you might go in with good intentions and sometimes it doesn't pan out, or maybe it pans out later and it doesn't have a linear, it doesn't go in a line. It branches out, because that's how it works within the nature of interdependence. So in some way, you know, we're not in total command. We only see a little piece of things. The world, therefore, is not a resolvable place. Now, wait, you have to let me finish, because I know this could get you revved up.
I am.
I'll just say one thing. It's a big idea, so I have to finish it and then ask, okay? So when I say the world is not a fixable or resolvable place, I'm not saying it's broken. What I'm saying is it's dynamic. It's too rambunctious for the likes of our ideas. So there's a lot of potentiality in the fact that things are not fixable. So I'm not saying that in a negative way. I'm just saying there's too much movement and energy to know. At the same time, yet, because everything leans, everything we do matters. And so we have to try with all our might to respond. And I do feel when we understand who we are in relationship to everything else, it's very alive and it's very poignant. And you won't be able to hold not serve. You will always go around asking what serves, like all the great beings of this place that we see, all the great saints. So in a way, it's a conundrum. It can be seen as a conundrum if the mind is dualistic. We can't fix it, yet we have to try.
Yes, and there's another aspect to this, it seems to me, which is that if we're coming to the end of the age and entering a new one, which is informed more honestly about how things really are, which is everything is interconnectedness, then this gives science a huge new challenge, because in truth, you can't just measure things in a reductionist way. You have to measure them systemically. And yet scientists, understandably, the scientist in me wants to understand the world through this new prism of interconnectedness. And you're worrying me with the scale of the relativity of your...
Patrick, I don't think it's the scientist's problem. I think it's our problem with science. They have a very good process. The scientific method is a good method. It's yielded great results. We've given it too much, not just power, we think it's giving us meaning. So science does not give us meaning. That is our job as a human community. So we can see what science is teaching us. We need to see not alternative facts, but facts. And we need to understand that humans are meaning-making people. I want to make a response to the healing question, too. And I want to go back to Haiti. The first pilgrimage that I helped lead in Haiti, we deliberately put it so that we would arrive in Jacmel on the southern coast port at the time of Carnival. It's the oldest carnival in the Western Hemisphere. And as we were driving into the town, there were very fierce-looking young adults who had painted their bodies. They were wearing very little, and they were painted black, they were painted dark blue, they were painted all kinds of grays and whites and other colors, and they were fierce, and they would come up to the windows of the cars that we were in and shake in the windows, and I asked one of the drivers, what are they doing? What is this? And they said, they are consciously inviting the wounded souls of the Native Americans who were enslaved and died and the black Africans who were enslaved and died into them so that they might be healed. Wow. So what I took from that was this is very much like the Christian practice of All Saints' Day and All Souls' Day when we pray for the dead and we believe the dead are praying for us. This is a living universe that transcends time as well as space. So when I pray for those who have died, what do I think is happening? I think I'm making myself available to God for the healing of that which has been broken in the past. In my own life, it's not a dispassionate thing. It's something personal. And that these young men and young women were doing that with those who had gone before them. I thought it was the most beautiful thing I'd almost ever seen.
So in order to prepare for the future, we have to repair the past.
In ourselves.
In ourselves.
Because that's where all this is, you see. I mean, it's the nature of interdependence. Part of a Buddhist understanding is that the world that is interdependent out there is also completely present in here. This whole world is in here. And in Christian terms, God as the Trinity, all the angels, all the demons, and the devil himself are all inside. And so the healing starts in the inner realm.
Can I just follow one more thing?
One point, because what I'd like to do in a moment is pause for a film. Okay. And then I'd like to invite our special guest up, but please.
Okay, I have a moment to say one thing. You know, you were saying that you want to know what to do, but like, this is why I use sticks. You can't know, because life doesn't lend itself to being known in a determinate way. That's the whole point of this. So it's interesting because we think knowing is capturing truth, but that's not really what knowing is. Truth cannot be captured because everything leans, it all depends. And so, you know, we can't fix the earth from one thing into another thing. That's not what the earth is. It's not a thing. Again, it's a dynamic that can't even be found.
Hold that question.
Okay.
Can we fix the earth? And let's have a discussion about that after the film.
Okay.
So we're ready for the film. Could we see the film? Hopefully. Well, so that rather poignantly underlined some of the conversation that we've just had. I'm now going to ask our third panelist to join us, and I believe that everything happens for a reason, and the reason why I'm here is because the man who's about to join us at my invitation, my request, suggested that I should moderate this panel, and I realized that actually the reason why he asked me was because I needed to ask him to come and join this conversation. So, Owsley Brown, will you come up and join us, please? Bless you. We're very happy for everything you've given to us over these last few days. And I think I would like to start to continue this conversation, which might lead to some questions, including can things be fixed, and other questions arising from what you both shared with us brilliantly. But Owsley, have you got anything to say?
Well, I don't know. Let's see. This is a mighty crew to be joining. Thank you, mighty crew.
Thank you, mighty one.
There were some things that occurred to me while listening to you. One was the subject of humility, and the other was to do with how that might relate to, let me think out loud, can I make a connection here? To the subject of attachment, and how that relates to kind of expectation. So I guess I'll work backwards. I think that what I hear you all saying, and I certainly think about a lot in my life, and has, I think, been brought forth in many ways over the course of these past days, is what to do with expectation in some way. And this is connected to intention, so I'll try to stream all these things, to link these things together. But, you know, I have just experienced in terms of noticing, you know, when you kind of tap into the territory that we're, I think, getting at, which is sort of the contemplative space, which, you know, definitely involves looking within, but then in some way is connected to experiencing without. Mm-hmm. And I guess the idea is the more you can dance a little bit between the looking within, the more you can notice different things when you're looking without, and all of a sudden things start informing in all kinds of dynamic directions. So that's very interesting. But this expectation thing to me is just somehow where the rubber meets the road. You know, we, in terms of fixability, and in terms of looking at history and time and so on, I mean, we are given what we're given in terms of social, cultural overlays. We're born into our families, which are part of our neighborhoods, which are part of our towns and our cities and our states, etc. And all those things have this inextricable link to at least just knowable history, let alone what we can't even fathom or comprehend because we haven't.
But, I mean, I've just been told, this is so interesting, I've just been told this, in less than 5 minutes there may be a very extraordinarily loud noise as a bunch of F-16s fly over us. So how interesting that so here I am, an angry activist in therapy, trying to calm myself to believe that nothing could be healed.
This is what I was trying to say, actually. This is actually the whole point I was trying to make. Like, we have this expectation that it should be all really mellow and I can make this big point or whatever we're all going to make. And, you know, we just really, we have no control. But does that mean that I shouldn't try to answer your question wholeheartedly? No, I think I should try to answer your question wholeheartedly. But the trick is, do I freak out when the F-16 goes over my head? And I really mean it. I really think this is, to me, where the rubber meets the road. Can we recognize that to go with all of our might, like find it within ourselves to just, like, we got 1 second left to live, what do we want to do all the time? Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, maybe if we pause enough, we can sort of think, well, maybe if I were to live, you know, a little bit longer than a second, I might actually dream of doing two things instead of just one. A la, you could have a little bit of information that you can reflect on and say, well, okay, this might be a good way to go. And you do that and you go for it, but you somehow can find a way, which I think is what this contemplative practice is all about, to truly be okay with whatever comes. I mean, I don't know how else to say it. I really think that's, I mean, is that what you're talking about?
So Elizabeth, please.
I think it's for the mind that tends to divide things, it's a conundrum. You either fix it or you don't. I'm not talking about that. You know, and I do think there's a difference between fixing and healing. And maybe I could say something about that. But looking at realistically at the fact that everything leans, we don't know, we don't even see the whole picture. So we all have a different idea of what is it we want to fix. But fix means bringing something to a static state of peaceful equilibrium. That's not a possibility.
So we're not going Nothing to stop happens. Walls.
It well, it may, also no, means, you know. You,
but that's a very singular idea. Like, what does it mean to fix the world? The world is a huge place. Every inch of Earth is different and changing and dynamic. So it's not even a singular thing. And it's influenced by so many other things, and we don't have control over it. So fixing this idea of bringing it to a static state of what we think it should be, no, that doesn't sound realistic, does it to you? And yet, healing, does it mean that we have no efficacy? No. This is a sensitive system. Because everything leans, we have tremendous power to influence what happens. And so this is what's called a bodhisattva.
But not control outcomes.
But yeah, we can't control. That's
so
not realistic.
We can strive, but we must strive not expecting a certain outcome.
And accepting. If I can just say strive to open our view and vision and keep going and keep going. And then when it feels more really uncomfortable, keep going. And then when it feels really uncomfortable, keep going. Like, how open can we really be? Because that's a very powerful thing too, because then all of a sudden expectation, the field within which expectation is occurring is expanding, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So there's more room for a variety of outcomes if our experiential view and how we hold our experience can open up a bit.
Right.
So can we fix the conflict in Syria? Can we sort the farm bill out?
Let me say, fix comes from the machine metaphor. Fix comes from the machine metaphor. So I'm old enough that you could actually fix a car. I mean, you could actually climb under the hood and find the broken part, take it out, and put another one in. And that is how we came to think of the world, as like that. It's part of the objectification of the world. So I think that skipping fix is a good idea, right? But heal is a completely different thing. Mm-hmm. It's an English word. It comes from wholeness, the idea of things being integrated. And that we can work towards. And one of the ways we can work toward it is this inner-outer. As I said, everything is in you. And so as they say in psychology, if you spot it, you got it. So if you see something that either attracts you deeply or repulses you deeply,
it's in you.
You're being asked. You're being asked by yourself to look within and find what that is and to bring it into a more conscious wholeness within.
Yes.
And that starts to heal the world outside because of the leaning quality of the world. So you see it, you start to give it voice, let it integrate, and because it's all connected, the system starts to change as well.
I sense you're frustrated with my state, and that
no,
there's
I'm
more
not
you
at
need
all.
To
I
share.
Think you're, whatever you're working with right there is really helpful in pressing at the point that needs to be pressed at, and I appreciate it. You know, but I think also you consider this is a really important point, this fixing and healing. And but you should also know that it's because everything leans that you can influence.
Right.
If things didn't lean, they'd be inert.
It means it's a system.
It's good news, you know.
Yeah.
But we say in our tradition, you know, we have that term bodhisattva. Bodhisattva is somebody who sees that the world is not a static place, who understands the nature of interdependence, which means things are not fixed, and can bear it, bear that not being right, bear that not knowing things in a determinate way, while at the same time trying with all their might to change the sufferings of the world and be there for everyone. So sometimes I phrase it as, you know, someone who burns with love in a world they can't fix. And so that's a bodhisattva's, that to rest in that conundrum is the resting place of the bodhisattva.
Because your motivation in that case isn't to fix,
it's to respond.
Yes, so I want to ask you if this is what you mean, and I've always taken this when you've said this. All this language is so interesting, but the idea of being in relationship is, I think, you know, to me, this is an in relationship little mudra. And that is so profound to me, because particularly if you go back to this thing that I was just mentioning about how open can we be, mm-hmm. the problem is we want to choose what we're in relationship with. And that is a big problem, because, for example, most of us, for example, myself, does not want to be in relationship with mortality, for example. You know? I don't want
to
die.
Just to pick one out,
you know,
of
just to pick one thing, you know, just that, you know. So, I mean, for example, you know, but that is a big-time problem.
Yeah.
Because
and also, another issue related to this is that we have a responsibility to work with all these forces that are in the world.
Yeah.
If the transition is only just undergoing now, and there are many people who see the world in a very different way than you've been showing with us, then we need to find a way to communicate with people who are still maybe just slightly behind the curve of change that's going on, you know?
That's what we want to do here.
Yeah.
Well, as you know, the story of the Sleeping Beauty is the key to everything.
Right.
And so the reason that's true, it's not about the kiss of the prince, it's about the baptism, the christening of the princess. And her parents, the king and the queen, sent out invitations, but they deliberately left one fairy out because she was a problem. She's the problem relative. And so 11 of the fairy godmothers have given their gifts of love in the way of wishes to the princess, and then Carabos blows in to the room full of wrath because she's been left out. She's not in the picture. And she curses the princess and says, "You will die when your finger is pricked." But then the little dumpy, as Disney tells it, the little dumpy last fairy godmother comes out and says, "No, I've got one more wish and I can ameliorate this. I can't make it go away, but I can bring some healing to this." So it's the leaving out of not relating to the forces of the world, dark or shadowy or light, that causes the system to be out of whack.
Do you think this is a good moment to open up this discussion?
I think it's a good moment. Yeah.
I'm wondering if there's a microphone. Is there
supposed to be a microphone?
I'm going to just come forward. Who would like to share their thoughts with us?
We do have the house light problem, but I think we can manage it. We can't see you, but the microphone holder.
Oh, here we are.
Stephen or Doug, and we have a microphone.
Is there a microphone in the house?
Yeah, coming right there.
Someone is rising.
Right, here's feet. There we go. So that goes right.
Here we go in the second row.
Yeah.
Could they bring up the house lights a bit?
Yeah, could we have that?
I think it's, unfortunately, I think it's an all or nothing kind of deal. So, I mean, not that we shouldn't have
We
all.
Stay with what is.
But yeah, well, there we go. It's coming up. I think, well, yeah, good.
Perfect. The chandeliers are lit.
Yeah.
Please.
The fairy godmothers have arrived.
So many words I could say to start this question, including relationship and healing and reconciliation and justice. I'm thinking, I'd like to hear your thoughts on the importance or the value of acknowledging our relationships that we don't want to connect with, specifically white privilege and Christian imperialism that brought us to the turning that requires the great turning. Mm-hmm. So please, your thoughts.
Thank you for that.
I can do one quick thing. I had dinner with Sadiqua Reynolds last night, and we talked specifically about this, and her request of me and our table was, don't worry so much. You know, just kind of like little, you know, it's like, believe me, she basically was saying, have some guts. She said, face what you don't want to face as it relates to white privilege and the stain of slavery. And we didn't even talk about, the genocide of Native peoples in all of the Americas. But her point was, please just have the conversation. And obviously forums matter, you know. She was also suggesting that not everybody can have the conversation at the same level. So try to find, you know, basically make the bar low enough that you feel you can succeed. I thought that was very interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The Christian word that gets used as repentance is, I think, a pretty poor translation of the word that occurs in the New Testament. And that word is metanoia. And noia is your mind, but it's much more than your brain. It's your whole sentience. And meta is another one. So to repent in the original sense is to get a mind that is necessary for this moment, rather than the mind that was adequate for the moment's past. And I think that relates to what Owsley's saying, is that, or your dinner mate last night, is that it's not so much about guilt or shame, but about truly openly seeking the mind that we together need for this new turning.
Another question, please.
Yes, thank you. Okay, it's on. hi, my name is Ganga Devi. I know most of the people on the stage, but not all of you. My comment isn't so much a question, but I would like to add to the conversation, if that's all right. I attended the Radical Compassion Symposium at Naropa a few years ago, and Vandana Shiva, many of you hopefully know, she's one of the most incredible activists on the planet right now. She's a fierce farmer and one of the greatest enemies of Monsanto. She's doing amazing work on behalf of the whole planet. And a huge takeaway that I had from that experience that I'd like to offer to the conversation is that she said that we can't be attached to the fruits of our labor. Mm-hmm. As farmers, as activists, as people doing the best that they can on this planet, all we can control is the impulse from which our actions come. And that's what I hear coming through this entire festival. And I'd also like to speak very, very briefly to what the bishop was saying at the end of your presentation about the singularity and about technology. As a young person who has recently become involved with not just the ecological work that I do and the interfaith work that I do, but also a lot of like tech millionaires in Silicon Valley recently. Yeah. And the work that they are focused on has so much to do with what has been discussed during this festival, and I wish many of them were here. I'm going to be going there in a few weeks, and I'm planning and bringing what I've gathered from this experience to them, because they are focused on regenerating the planet. They are focused on increasing the capacity of humans for compassion through technology.
Yeah.
And it's remarkable, the work that's being done, and I'm so deeply encouraged by it. I used to be incredibly cynical, and now I'm just remarkably full of hope, a hope that's based in constant action, because I recognize that every moment, not just marching, but every breath, mm-hmm. every thought, every prayer has massive implications.
Yeah.
And I've learned that through the years of studying with Elizabeth and through understanding interdependence with the work of Joanna Macy as well. So I just love to thank all of you, and from my generation, to encourage you all that we're taking on much of the mantle, and to thank you all for the work that you all are doing as well.
Thank you. Well, maybe you've got some comments on the technology part of her question, but I would like to share with you my thoughts about the first part, which is relating to Vandana Shiva, who is undoubtedly one of the most remarkable communicators and activists on the planet today. But she is, as you said, she's a friend of mine, angry. And the place of anger, righteous anger, when witnessing violations of various kinds, in Vandana's case, her concern is both of the peasant farmers of India and elsewhere, but also of the violation on nature, What is the place of anger in the response that we have to the sort of issues that we've been discussing throughout this conference?
I'd like to take that, if I could. You know, first of all, if you're angry at anyone or anything, you're going to have to be angry at the nature of interdependence. Because that's who's responsible for things working out the way that they do, actually. You know, people...
Angry at the nature of...
Of interdependence.
Of interdependence. So you're saying that anger... Are you saying that anger is an inappropriate response?
I'm not saying it's an inappropriate, but I think it's a response that comes from not seeing how things are, if I may be so bold. I think to fiercely want to respond to the world around you, that's extremely noble. And I can see you have that in
spades.
So
there's a difference between fierceness and anger.
Well, I'm just making that distinction in that anger has that kind of divisive quality. It has a certain rightness in it. It has rightness in it. And I think more awe and less rightness helps us relate more accurately to the world as it is.
Mark, Owsley, do you want to say something?
I mean, Elizabeth's always right. And I think anger, if anger is repressed, I mean, if you don't feel there's a place for anger, then that probably means that anger needs to be voiced.
Yes, because surely it is one of the most important issues of
it's
our
there.
Time
yeah.
at this event and in relation to what's happening in the world. I mean, yeah. And you know the homeopathic theory of miasm,
right.
that if you suppress something, it comes out.
That's what I'm saying. So that's this integrating work. It is in us. It may not be healthy to hold on to. Certainly it's not. But to not voice it is also a danger, it seems to me.
How can that be reconciled?
Well, there's a, you know, I wanted to talk at some point, maybe another festival perhaps.
We only have 7 minutes.
I know. I won't. But the passage where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, as he makes his way to his friend, one of his best friend's tomb, he stops twice. And this word occurs only, one of them only occurs in Greek literature, in this place and a couple of other places in all of Greek literature. And it's a word for being stirred up inside. And it's almost like he deliberately stirs up his power that he's going to direct towards the righting of this wrong. And so that kind of anger, I think, like we can think of Shiva, overcoming ignorance. We can think of, there's 2 good examples.
Yeah. Good.
Yeah.
Owsley.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's understanding the nature of interdependence, which is, you know, for me, it's certainly an ongoing exercise. And then there's, I'm just incredibly ignited with anger by a thing problem. Mm-hmm. So to me, those are 2 things I wrestle with. One is understanding the nature of interdependence and trying to kind of assimilate that into my whole being best as I can. And then there's the what do I do when my button gets pushed problem, you know? And I do seem to notice that my button is maybe a little less easier, a little harder to push, or let's say when it's put, this is what I notice. Recovery is a little easier with some practice. But I do think that the energy itself is just that. I mean,
yes,
it's an energy, and it should be looked at and understood and respected for what it is,
right.
But not reified.
Right.
I mean, I think that's this idea.
And that's the dividing
that's the
line in our tradition. That the rightness is what is the reification.
That's the reification thing. That idea of making your anger the truth.
Yeah.
That becomes the big problem.
Okay. Brief comments on the technology.
Well, I think that it's so encouraging what you said, and I think the idea, I think there's a great longing, it's what Owsley has said to me, in Silicon Valley and elsewhere for this conversation. I think we're longing for it, and we're longing for it, because it's not just they, we're the ones using this technology 24/7 in every way, and we're dragging it with us into this new world. It's incumbent on us who are meaning seekers to be in this conversation with people who want to be in the conversation. So I would say we need to invite them to the Festival of Faith.
Good idea. Yeah.
Serious comment, actually. Yes. Serious okay. comment.
Yeah, okay. I'll echo that. I mean, please invite them to the Festival of Faith. We're having one in 12 months. It would be great. I've got lots of seats, hotel rooms. No problem
maybe
for you and your friends.
Even do after the Sacred Feminine on
yeah, technology would be a great
on the singularity.
On the singularity, it's a super great idea.
Right. No,
I'm not trying to push that.
Yeah.
This may be the last question, unless there's somebody else who's got a burning point.
I would. What,
okay, two more then. We'll have them both.
I enjoy this conversation very much. I would just like to add that we are part of a conversation thousands of years old. Beginning with Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, and especially Descartes and the Cartesian dualism of the cogito. You raised the question, Bishop, a while ago about the French Revolution, Napoleon, the 17th century Enlightenment, and the dualism that comes out of that, the narcissism of the cogito. And I think John McMurray, a Scottish philosopher, has addressed it very well. I would really like to hear John McMurray a part of this conversation. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And there's one more, I think, is there?
Yeah, right here.
Here we go.
No, right here.
Oh, here.
It's on, just start.
Yeah, oh, Jesus. I was born in Scotland, raised in Canada, lived here for 15 years. Now I've been back in Canada for the next 8 years. Been going to the Festival of Faith for 22 years. I'm disappointed that things haven't changed as much as I thought they should. And the faces in the audience are still white, predominantly, and wealthy. And so it's systemic change that needs to happen. You need to get rid of the racism, the uneducated. There's 181 million uneducated girls in the world. What are we doing about that? If you want to change the world, you educate your girls.
Well, I certainly should speak for the... Yeah,
There's one, I think, did you want to... Can we just have the last one, because then we can...
I was just going to say, I should speak for the festival just because they just showed up at my invitation, or our invitation. I mean, look, what I can tell you is, having now gotten into this on the local level best as I can, it is incredibly real work. And I would invite you, I mean, really, in all seriousness, to come after this and let's huddle and let's, you know, get each other's contact and we can share ideas, because the work is never going to end, I don't think. There's always going to be injustice. There's always going to be imperfection. And that's back to this thing of the intention. I'm sensing, I can't see you, but I can hear you. The frustration is what's fueling me. I know it's what's fueling our team. And I don't mean to sound defensive. I mean to sound in solidarity with you. Like, you got it. That is the problem. That is the big time problem. And it seems to me kind of we've always had big time problems. And hopefully we can have a whole lot less of them. And if we don't, who knows what we're going to have, because the stakes are so high, the situation is so fragile, we got to go like crazy. But in the face of disappointment, we still got to go like crazy.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's, to me, when you say it's unfixable, it means actually, and you got to double down almost. Mm-hmm. It's not it's unfixable and you give up. It's unfixable and you just keep going and going and going. So. But please, after the session, let's get together.
Okay, thank you. And now we've got the last point.
So Owsley may have just answered my question, and I don't mean to sound smart aleck, but I understand the epistemological thing about the sticks. I understand the semantics between fix and heal, but I'm really worried about the planet, and I'm wondering, what am I supposed to do about things like climate change, other than try to heal myself? It seems like I have the luxury to try to move the ball further along and that I should. And so I want to hear what message you mean to say about that, please.
Well,
thank you very much for that question.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're speaking to, by the way, a major activist and political
fabulous
champion and hero of this region and town.
Okay, so. Well, then I won't.
Yeah, sorry, just so you know. No, please answer.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
What I was trying to say this morning about the ability for us to be part of the actual solution, the keeping the U.S. commitment to the Paris Agreement is, I believe, a very important idea. The U.S. agreement is very simple. It is taking 2005 as a base and reducing carbon in the United States, carbon production by 28% by 2025. This is doable, and it is work that we can do, and it is work that will not be done under the auspices of the federal government. So that's my answer. We can do this, and the faith communities, which is this the festival of, we could play a significant role in that.
Elizabeth.
So, you know, Bishop Mark is an organizer. I'm not so much of an organizer, but I think there are opportunities everywhere to be of benefit. And I think when you're awake and you're feeling yourself in the nature of interdependence, you find opportunities everywhere all day long. And I just mean in very simple ways. I mean even recycling. Or, you know, sometimes it's I feel myself frustrated because you look at these huge problems and you do want something to change. I mean, it's not as if I don't want something to change. I just am looking at the nature of how things are, but I have that longing. It's like that burning feeling. It's a poignancy. It's not passive whatsoever. I do also agree that we can't afford to be passive. We have to respond. We have to always be awake and looking. And sometimes, you know, activism to me, I almost want to rephrase it as responsiveness, because, you know, you're in the pool, you have a lane to yourself, and there's always this tension about getting a lane, and somebody comes, you know, is waiting at the edge of the pool and they're feeling anxious, and you say, hop in. And like, it changes the whole feeling of the situation, and all day long they feel sustained, and you feel sustained by the goodness or the nobleness of your own mind. I don't know what, like recently my dad was in ICU and then he had to go into a rehab for 3 weeks, and I went into the nursing home, and there's all these old people, and it's very painful. And, you know, one lady was saying, you know, fretting about her hair. I think she had Alzheimer's, and she said, nobody loves me, nobody loves me. And she was like howling, and I said, and then I just felt so stirred, and I said, well, I love you. And she said, you do? And I said, yeah, I do. And then her whole demeanor changed. And then the nurse came up and asked her, do you want to go? They're having some music and dancing. And she got up in her chair and she started like going like this all the way down the hall, like doing the cha-cha. It was so sweet. And I realized you can turn around someone's, you talk about a world, that is changing the world for somebody in that moment. It's not a fix, it's a heal. And that's all, because it's, you know, when we talk about these big issues, like what do we do about North Korea? What do we do about the earth? Where is the earth? I can't find it. I mean, I see the picture, but it's not necessary. That's so abstract to me. So I feel overwhelmed and fall into despair that way. But when I realize I need to have a more direct relationship with reality, which is what I can do in the moment. Like if I find myself in a situation where I'm poised to do something that very broad, I will do it. But most people don't find themselves with that much power. I mean, who wouldn't want to do that? So you do everything you can, or you organize like Mark does. Right.
And
so,
can I just want to add too, because I think that like this is obviously an age-old question, let's just say, for the sake of discussion, to the point that was made earlier. This is not, so is there, does a contemplative life have a role for an audience like this? I would say absolutely. Yeah. I mean, theoretically, you would be gone if you know, from this session at least, if you didn't think there was something that you were at least curious to learn about. And if that curiosity is as genuine as I believe it to be, I am here to say, at least from my own point of view, I know these three would agree, that is essential. Wisdom is, we think, at the Festival of Faith, there's such a thing as wisdom, and that it's super important, and that it could be forgotten, and we should never forget it. Now, how are you going to go about that? Whole other conversation, but let's just park that. I know that Patrick he founded the organic movement in the UK, and he was, you know, fight the power kind of guy for 30 years. And he had his own epiphany right here. I'm talking about your meeting at Yum, where he went in as a really, I mean, one of the most important global voices, best friends with Vandana Shiva on the fight to power on big ag, you know, versus a sustainable vision for how we can all live on this planet with respect to agriculture. And he sat opposite the chief executive officer of, you know, one of the biggest fast food companies on the planet. And what he told me, I should let you speak, but it's sort of fun to speak for you. What he told me coming out of that meeting was, wow. What I encountered, Owsley, when I sat opposite the chief executive officer of Yum Brands, was a fellow human being who was actually doing everything that he could do relative to what he understood, what he believed in, what he could get his head and heart around, relative to what he could do. And actually, by kind of receiving his relative truth, Patrick told me, they went on to have a very dynamic exchange, which is still going on to this day. And Patrick said to me, coming out of that meeting, this us and them model that I was a leader of for a really long time is over. Mm-hmm. It's us and us alone. And what do we want to do about it?
Mm-hmm. So, Owsley,
that's right. Is that right?
It is. That's great.
So,
speaking
the key
of
for me and what you said was receive.
Yeah.
So Patrick received his truth into him. I mean, he received it into him. And that's where the healing starts to take place.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's time. And I think, I imagine there are some closing words. Is this right?
Yeah, this is it. So, Did I tell that story right? Was that all right?
Yes, I'll say a word about that now. But I would like to say this. That for me, this conversation has been profound and really, it's brought me to the edge of deep questions that I'm living with and have lived with for years. And I don't think you can do, you know, that's for me the most important thing, to be in front of these profound questions. And so I would just like to say thank you to Marc, to Elizabeth, and to Owsley for joining me for this conversation.
Thank you,
do we leave the stage for the closing remarks?
No, you should. Well, I don't think so, but let me double check with my boss, which is Sarah Reed Harris, the intrepid, the incredible, the glorious, and I don't know, there she is. So I'll just speak while she's walking up to this podium where she will take over the mic.
It's a very strange experience up here, you know, because nobody is shining like the sun.
Yeah.
We're working on that. Yeah. But next year, we'll make sure that you're shining, you know, just teasing. But this is this brings this unbelievable journey.
Amazing.
Good job. Another one, you know, in the books there.
Let's bring them up.
Let's bring them up. So we'd like to bring our team. Thank you so much. We have our team.
Alina, Mustafa, Mahogany, Kim, Marcel, Key, Bird, anyone.
If you don't mind sustaining your applause, we have a few.
Rebecca!
Doug Beachwood, our producing director of this whole festival. You move right there. Keep going.
Nicole, I know you're out there by that monitor. Get in here.
Okay.
Our check writers, our airline bookers and lodging bookers,
okay,
and social media and website. Community outreach, fundraising. Doug, we need you to bring your whole team out here. Doug Beachwood. Doug Beachwood. Doug.
Thank you. Okay, here we go.
Ask Doug.
Okay, we have more. You can pause, but if you can fire up that applause in a second.
No?
Well, maybe we're not going
to
get him.
I think it's important to know what's going on behind the scenes and reaching out to the world. So, Doug Beachwood, could you come up and just give the names of your team? Did he leave?
So, tell them about next year. How are we going to reach out to everybody about next year?
How are we going
to
reach
soon.
Out
to
technology
reach out to you
sounds
soon.
Like one way we're definitely going to do it. The big unifier.
We're still, you okay? We're still wrestling with exactly what four-day period, and it will either be in April or May.
April or May.
And we will know soon, and definitely the territory of the feminine is the thematic direction, and it will be our best attempt.
I think,
Marc Andrus might have suggested a possible territory. I don't know. It was conscious wholeness. I kind of liked that. I wouldn't mention that earlier, but we're in that domain.
So this is the backstage story, and we're so grateful to each and every one of you, really. Thank you all so much. And was your team going to make it out?
Yeah, I think so. Okay,
we're almost
there.
I will call
them by name regardless.
Yes.
So many thanks to my brother, Kevin Beachwood, who is cutting the show for the live stream. Amy Whaley, who is keeping us on distinct and accurate time and doing many untold and wonderful things backstage. Dylan Novak, who is our editor-in-chief, making sure that all of this lives in posterity on YouTube. John Humphreys, who is maintaining the stream with us from KY Cities. Ryan Daly, the unstoppable Ryan Daly of Cinema Anonymous here in Louisville, our expert projectionist and tech extraordinaire. Has been stage managing with us all week. Thank you.
Okay.
It's been a pleasure serving this festival for the past 5 years.
Can we all hold hands and we'll say, see you next year, everybody. Bye-bye.
Do you have any music?
Thank you.
So, you ready?
Oh, wait, silence. I guess that we got to do that, don't we? Yeah. All right, here we go. Final 3 minutes. Okay, the clock says 6:43. That'll be a longer silence, though. Okay. Are you ready? Sylvia Bourgeau was talking about, Cynthia Bourgeau was talking about the dedication of merit. So if any of you heard that, that was a beautiful expression of something that we could all do if we wanted to now. Thank you.